All right. I don't even know what I'm calling it. But welcome to a tech update, ladies and gentlemen. I have here. Okay, since you're not going to do it. Thomas. He does a, he has a YouTube channel also. He does tech and he's into tech. Thomas.
Hello, people.
All right, so this way it's probably, you guys probably want to see, you know, his face or something like that, but we don't have it set up through Skype, so we're just going to be doing it, you know, this way you get to see me, and yeah, that's pretty much. All right, let's move on with the tech update.
Yes, let's move on
now. Yes, this one here is 2 weeks ago. But it's the AMD Arctic Islands 400 series, you know, set to launch in 2016 of summer. So,
two times the performance per watt, and it will be on the 14 and 16 nanometer FinFET.
That is correct, and it's going to have H. Will it like have HBM 2.0 or it will, right? It says it right there.
Yeah, it will.
Yeah. So. 4 gigs though? Is that what? Okay, they're talking about the Fury X here. All right, so that's probably going to be maybe 6 or 8 gigabytes. Don't know.
I believe that the high end will at minimum have 8 gigs, because the reason why the Fury lineup didn't have that many gigs of HBM memory was that was the limit. 4 gigs was the limit for HBM1. And if you look at the R9 390 series, they have 8 gigs of RAM. So I don't see them digressing when it comes to how much memory that the cards will have when it comes to the high end. All
right. That's pretty much on point there. So, yeah, definitely says it right here. I just have to scroll down a little bit too. So HBM 2.0, 8 gigabyte per DRAM die. Jesus Christ. Damn.
That's pretty huge.
That is big. 2 gigabits per second. Yeah, it's pretty good. It's pretty good. So 2016 summertime is when this is expected to come out. So we'll definitely be keeping our eyes on this and looking through, you know, those Chinese forums and stuff and looking at leaked benchmarks. So, yeah, we're gonna keep our eyes on this. All right, next up, what we got? What we got next, man?
AMD's answer to NVIDIA GameWorks.
Damn. Where's that at? Hold up. Yeah, here we go. So this actually makes me pretty excited, because, well, first of all, it's open. Second, well, first of all, it competes with NVIDIA's, you know, GameWorks. And second is open, so that's a good benefit. And you know, it's about time, Jesus Christ, it's about time they're actually coming out with something here to really compete with on the NVIDIA side. Even though with the NVIDIA GameWorks, you know, generally it doesn't give you that good performance when you enable certain NVIDIA features like TXAA or the physics and stuff like that. You'll always get frame drops. You need a really beastly rig anyway. So you know, we'll see what AMD actually has to offer here with all the graphic effects and their tools and stuff that allows you allows devs also to actually port games back and forth. So that's just it looks promising.
Yeah, I think this is going to be a game changer. The reason why I feel not as in like sales and marketing and stuff like that, but I feel like it's going to be a game changer because now. Like any developers or just developers that don't pay for NVIDIA GameWorks will now have things that's competing with NVIDIA GameWorks under the MIT's open license. So anybody can improve on this and then just re-upload it. You could literally take it, improve on it, and then re-upload it so everybody else could use it because it's under the MIT's open source license.
Yeah, that actually sounds pretty good.
Yeah, so I'm really looking forward to see what people are going to use this for. I think a lot of indie developers are going to make really good use of that.
Oh yeah, definitely. This would be great too, since I'm likely going to be going back to AMD pretty soon. Yeah, definitely excited about that, and to see what new their own works they're gonna pop up with, their own graphic effects and stuff like that, to really compete with Nvidia. So, definitely looking forward to this. So Nvidia, you look out now. Let's go ahead and is there anything else you want to add to it besides that, or right?
It just seems like it's going to be pretty useful. I mean, it seems like AMD is on their game this year with announcing Zen and the 400 series and what the architecture is going to be like. Is I think AMD really is trying to reform its outlook.
Okay, definitely. I definitely see that with them revamping what used to be Catalyst Control. So giving it a new overlook. What is it called again?
Radeon software.
Radeon Software. Yeah, it looks pretty good. That's everything comes together, looks, performance, usability. So putting all that together, I don't know about Zen, but because I don't, we got to go back to the Phenom. Even though they're doing some things and stuff like that, I'll still wait. I'm not gonna throw my panties in the air or anything like that. I'm just gonna wait. I do have hope for them. They're saying 45% IPC performance improvements. But this definitely looks, with the NVIDIA on the GPU side of things, definitely is looking up. So with them coming out with their own competitive software to compete with NVIDIA GameWorks with their graphical effects and stuff like that. So definitely hope developers, really get into it, and it's open. So all right. Let's go ahead and move on to the next one. What you got?
All right, exploring NVIDIA's Pascal and Volta architectural lineup. GB100 could be the first truly 4K 60 FPS compatible GPU.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this I'm gonna have to go back here.
See, one thing
It's
I got to say about this is that I'm not 100% sure that it will be the first GPU to be able to do 4K 60 FPS because, if I'm remembering right, AMD has priority to HBM2. So the way that comes to me is that AMD will be able to release products with HBM2 before NVIDIA will. So if that's the case, then this is voided.
Well, I mean, okay. For 4K 60 FPS. Now, this it's going to come down to the game, because with the 290X, I clearly remember them doing the same thing when they had their press event about the card, and they had Dirt 3 in the background, or in the lineup, wherever you can go and check it out. But they had the game playing at 4K 60 frames a second, because Dirt 3 isn't a very complicated game to run. So, it just really depends. Really, I mean, if you can definitely push the next Battlefield 5, those really high graphically intensive games at 60 FPS 4K, then we'll see. Definitely, I think it might be a little possible. 4K is a huge resolution, so yeah, I mean, 60 FPS. Maybe, because I'm really considering HBM and everything, and how much faster it is than HBM, the first generation HBM. And you have the capacity of more memory, but mainly how much more faster it is, how much faster it is. So I think it might be a little possible. It still does also come down to the core, not just memory by itself. So the core also has to be capable to actually handle, everything that's being thrown at it. So yeah. All right. Yeah, that looks good. That picture looks good. That looks really nice. I would just love to stick this right here. I don't want to click on it, but I just love to stick this right here in my PC. It's like you know the small PCB that they showed, the really small one. Yeah, it looks good. That's good. That looks good. Okay. So yeah, definitely. I think it might be a little possible. However, I don't know when it comes to really graphic intensive games. I just don't know how it's gonna do. But older titles and stuff like that will definitely be able to do it.
And
So.
that's something that I'm really like guessing about, is they're talking about just like average quality games, or are they talking about like the Witcher
Yeah,
quality of type of games?
definitely.
So
So, I mean,
that's one thing to look out for.
yeah. So we'll see. We're not really gonna pass anything, but yes, the RAM and everything, the onboard VRAM and everything is gonna be fast, but it also comes down to the core. So the core has to be powerful also to handle it. So we'll definitely keep an eye on this. So yeah, damn, it looks good. Hey, that is sexy. Is that an X? Oh, damn, that's actually pretty cool. All right. So the lighting effects. The light, I guess, hit the GPU and actually, or they put that in there. I don't know. All right. So what's the next topic we got up here? Because I'm all over the place. It's all over the place.
The
So.
next thing we have is the Intel Sky Lake CPU
Woo
bending under pressure.
Oh man, this. Hey. I was actually kind of skeptical about this also. I didn't think this would actually happen because I thought, hey, maybe Intel actually knows what they're doing. When I actually saw this, I said way back when it first came out, I saw them comparing it just like this, showing that the actual, I want to say the board or PCB is actually thinner. And I'm like, that's I don't know. It'll just hold up because Intel knows what they're doing. So it is actually bending under certain coolers, which is oh, look at that. Oh man, that is just oh, I can't look. I just can't look at it.
They need to really like need to update the specifications to how much pressure you can put on the CPU before it bends, or they need to just find out a different foundation that they could do to make it more sturdy. Because CPU bending, especially the way that Intel have their CPU, where there's no pins on the CPU, it's just that's a big problem. Because if your CPU bends, there are pins that you literally cannot reach, so you cannot use that. We don't know what functionality you might lose, and then it might be something where the voltage is now being just wicked, it's just everywhere.
This looks like it might just, especially at the corner here, it looks like it's just gonna cut some traces, obviously, and cause instability or for it to not work anymore. That's just bad. I don't. Do you have any idea as to why they made the PCB thinner? I don't.
I cannot. I mean, they. I cannot really say. I cannot really say why they made the PCB thinner.
I
I
don't
know they're on
understand
a
why they would
smaller
do this.
node. I know they're on a smaller node, but as to why they made the PCB thinner, I'm not. I'm 100% sure on that,
It
and
looks like dirt in his nails.
that's why I feel like they need to either reconstruct it, or they need to update the specifications of how much pressure you can put on this chip.
As someone that's buying something like this, you shouldn't have to worry about your CPU bent. That is the weirdest thing. I've never heard of this before. I've never seen anything like it before.
Me neither.
But yeah, that's it's really weird as to that happening. I mean, it's thinner, so you gotta kind of expect that could happen unless they use some kind of redefined material. So, but that's obviously not the case here. And yeah, they're gonna fix that, obviously. I'm
They
sure
have
people are gonna
to.
get their their money back or get an exchange, whatever the case is. So that's kind of changes some things here with the 6700K. And the 6600K also. So, I don't know what their game plan is, what it's gonna be. It also bends the motherboard. I don't even have a.
Oh yeah,
I'm I don't. I don't have a. I don't think I have a photo here.
I believe it's a. I believe it's in Tom's Hard. It's an article in Tom's Hardware that shows it bending the motherboard.
There we go. We got PC Purr in the house. PC Purr in the house, and I'm going to be getting rid of a topic, of course. So here we go. Ooh, there it is. Yeah, certainly fluxing it a little bit. So yeah, that's it damages the motherboard too. That is not something you want to hear when you're spending about maybe $450, $500+ with the CPU and the motherboard together. You're just not this kind. This is horrible news. Man, this is really bad. So.
Man, you're gonna be spending more than just $500, especially.
The CPU is $350, and the motherboard is about a decent motherboard is about $100, right? Yeah. So decent, right?
Yeah, decent. But you know, if you more than likely, this is an enthusiast grade platform as of right now, because simply if you upgrade to this, you're on the bleeding edge of technology. So usually
yeah, definitely.
People like that tend to upgrade to the best motherboards they buy. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah. I definitely hear that. So yeah, I don't know what their plan is to really fix this, but just changing the PC. They obviously have a reason as to why they did it. Obviously has a reason why. I just don't know. We just don't know why they did it, but the reason's there. So that means the HIS is actually thicker to actually compensate for the thinner PCB. That's crazy. You shouldn't have to worry about, oh my gosh, should I buy this cooler? Is this cooler going to bend it? I'm going to freak out right now. You know, like you see people all over the phone, like, yo, what cooler don't bend the CPU? I want to know right now. Let me know. You know, I want to buy the wrong cooler and bend it. Bend my $350 processor.
Yeah.
Man. All right. Well, anything else more you got to say about this? This is that's ugly.
I think the title speaks for itself.
Yeah.
I don't think I have anything else to say.
All right. Let's move on to the next one. So it's, I don't know. I totally got everything mixed up. So I mean, bring it in.
First Zen coming to high end desktops in 2016.
Yes, AMD Zen. Let's talk Zen. So let's talk about some Zen. So 2016 should have 45%, right? Is it 44 or 45? 45%, right?
I believe it's 40. I believe it's 40%.
40, you over. Sure? I'm thinking 40. I think I've seen 45. 45% IPC performance improvements. So
I'm looking at the little spec sheet that AMD released. This 40%.
Scroll down. Damn. You know. Got it. All right. I see it now. All right. So definitely we can see that spike there looking nice. We got the Zen Plus, which should operate on the upcoming motherboard. I don't know, but it was AM4, right?
AM4, yeah.
AM4. I think if I'm following how AMD used to do things, the Zen Plus should also work on the previous motherboard. That's maybe.
Yes, they're talking about a set socket.
Yeah.
They're talking about AM4 be the set socket for Zen.
It's about time. Man,
I'm really liking this. I could go get me I could have me an APU which is they're expecting to bring Carrizo from the mobile to the desktop in like spring, so I would be able to upgrade to a Carrizo full core two modules CPU, and then it'll be on the AM4 platform with DDR4 memory, PCIe 3.0, you know, all the good stuff.
Yeah.
And then later on when they release the Zen, whatever they would name those CPUs, I would be able to jump from my APU to a Zen processor with just buying the processor. I don't have to go buy new memory. I don't have to buy a new motherboard. I don't have to do none of that. I just have to purchase the core.
And yeah, okay, yeah.
That's really useful.
Yeah, that's pretty good, you know, having an APU and like, let me go get some Zen, put the Zen in there. So that's definitely pretty good there. So yeah, we're kind of, you know, come on AMD, you can do it, man. We need the competition, especially with Intel. Obviously, they're really only competitor. So we definitely need them to come out with this processor. And I don't know, you know, because next year, it's okay. We got the enthusiast line. We got processors coming out on that line and the X99 updated stuff. But that's like way ahead, because you got extra cores and everything, like you got 6 cores and everything like that. So I want to know exactly how, you know, where this is gonna sit in terms of Intel's high end, like the 6700K. Is it gonna beat it, or like
I don't think the Zen is meant to beat Skylake. I think it's meant to approach Skylake levels.
Yeah, definitely. That's okay with me. That is totally okay with me.
I feel like it will be a couple of percent behind Skylake when it comes to IPCs. I feel like it would be a couple of percent behind.
Okay. Yeah, definitely. That's okay. You know, if it's a few percentage behind it, that's fine. You know, as long as they price it properly and don't go crazy. So but
hopefully it can overclock just as good as the excavator can. Mm-hmm. Hopefully it can overclock just like how Bulldozer can. And if it can overclock that good, then we just might not know that negative 2% when it comes to IPCs might get voided by you being able to overclock higher.
Yeah.
So let's just see what happens. Let's just see what happens.
Let's definitely. I'll definitely be looking up and see what's going on with this, because it's been a while, you know, in terms of, you know, on the high end line of things. You know, the last processor came out was the A9590, right? Did I get the number correct? Mm-hmm. The 95, the 5 gigahertz processor?
Yeah, 95.
What was also not very good about that processor is, I'm talking about like just price. When it first dropped, ooh, it was $1,000, right?
Yes, it was.
$1,000. For something that was overclocked. I mean, yes, it's bend and everything, but Jesus Christ, you're comparing an overclock 8350, you know, basically just overclocking the 8350, a higher bend chip that can, you know, can handle everything, the lower voltage, and be able to hit that frequency.
The reason why I feel like they did that was because they was able to breach the five gigahertz mark without being on LN2.
Well,
if I'm correct, AMD was the first to breach the 1 gigahertz mark.
Everyone's going back and forth with that. Somebody likes Intel, somebody's like AMD. I feel like it's probably AMD that breached that. But, you know, yes, when it comes to just taking out the box, putting it in the system, I'm kind of skeptical as to whether it probably does run at 5 gigahertz in all the cores. It likely would. So
it runs at 5 gigahertz.
So it's just out the box. Mm-hmm. So it's up to
5.2.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. 5.2 gigahertz overclocked. But yeah, I mean, I think the 2600K, which is i7, was actually able. It's older though, but overclocking, you know, you can, the people hit 5 gigahertz, so it's not as rare. So, but yeah, it's totally fine, I guess. It's all right. Just, you know, see what's going to happen with the Zen core, and what's going to happen there. So yeah, we'll definitely keep in touch with this. I will definitely be looking at, you know, benchmarks and leaks online and stuff like that, and see what people are saying about it. Can't really believe everything, but you know, it comes out, you just get to take a look, you know, just don't take it too seriously. So, 'cause you know, it's leaks and everything like
Take
that.
every single leak with a grain of salt.
Yes. A grain of salt. This guy says, yeah, then how does it beat the 2500K stock? I don't know. It probably will. Likely will. So, yeah, we'll definitely see. You know, we'll keep you guys updated. All right, what we got next? What's going
All
on? What we
right,
got next?
next we have the gaming news.
Oh, we done with the tech? What?
Yeah.
Oh, we're on the gaming side of things. All right. I don't play as much games lately. I play like single player games. You know, like I haven't played GTA 5 yet. Got it the day before it came out. Didn't touch the story. Just played multiplayer. But yeah, I'm a multiplayer guy and you know, stick to certain games. All right, so gaming news. What's up with? Let me close out some of these. Okay, go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. What you got up there?
So let's start with the gaming news. The first story is I wanna you know what? Hey, I'm not even gonna say nothing about it. Just it speaks for itself. Valve now allows you to permanently delete your games from your
Totally.
Steam library.
Totally close that one out. All right. Yes.
Why would I want to delete my games from my Steam library? You already have the feature for me to hide it. Why would I delete it?
This is really weird. It's strange. I would say the better option, maybe. Probably not for business, but you know, it will be to be able to sell the game, but then Steam would turn into G2A, basically. So that probably wouldn't work that way. But deleting it, I mean, where's my Steam library at? I mean,
Yeah, but if
okay.
they were to sell the game, they could sell it through Steam, and the developer would be able to get some type of percentage through that transaction. So even though the developer isn't selling it, the developer could still make a little bit of profit off of it, and Steam will too, since we're selling it on Steam. I think that would be a better option than if, oh, let's see. You
Okay.
got all them games on your account. You never played, let's say,
Yeah,
50 of
but
them.
I
All right, go
mean,
ahead and
okay.
permanently delete them.
Yeah, it's that's. I don't have anything here that I would want to permanently delete. I mean, game is a game. You know, if I get it for free or whatever the case is. If I buy a game, I gotta really want it. Everything on my list here is something I really want, unless. They're talking about the free to plays too. I mean, 'cause some you got free to play games here that oh yeah, Steam VR. We got free to play games that actually just stays on. Oh my God, okay, it just stays on your list when you uninstall it, even though they didn't purchase it. So it's really weird, you know. Maybe people want to clean up the clutter, you know.
Yeah.
In terms of finding games, I guess to install. I don't know. It's just I don't really see why. This is actually a thing.
One thing I can say about it is at least they made it so that you cannot accidentally permanently delete your games. In order for you to do it, you will have to go through their website and then go through support and click on the game and then click on the option, I want to permanently remove this game from my account. So at least they made it so that you have to go through loopholes and not just right click on the game and click permanently delete.
Okay, well that's good. That's good. Why would you want to? Oh my God, don't ever do
I
that.
don't understand.
Don't
I don't understand.
ever do that. Like he got the permanent delete on Fallout 4. No, go away. Yeah, I don't see it. I don't even know. Like people like you if you when you permanently delete it, like you don't get anything back. You lose the game. You spend $5 in it, gone. You spend like $20 in a game, you don't want no more, gone. Like you don't get anything back, no money back or anything like that. You're basically just throwing away $20, kind of, I guess. So it's I don't know, it's really weird. Like I said again, I don't really have anything here that I would want to permanently delete at all.
Hopefully, it's not some type of way that the hackers and the cheaters could get a back ban in that game and then permanently delete the game from their account, and the back ban goes away. Hopefully
Is
it
that
doesn't.
could that actually happen? I
I
mean,
mean, the back ban is tied to that game, as
it
far as
is?
I know.
Huh. Interesting.
Hopefully they have they already thought of that, and that doesn't happen.
Okay. Well, I mean, I didn't know it worked that way. I thought it was just on your account, no matter what you do. So, yeah,
Yeah, it's on
that's.
your account, but we never had the option to delete our games. And when you have the back ban, it says on what game you have that back ban. How can you have the back ban if you already permanently deleted your game?
Yeah. That's I don't really know. I was
So
thinking.
let's hope. Let's just hope.
Yeah, I was again, like I said, I was thinking maybe you could just like have the option to sell the game so that the developer gets some back, Steam gets some, I get some wallet funds. But essentially what that'll do, nobody will ever probably buy a new game again. And Steam will become the new G2A. So it wouldn't work that way. And that's the reason why they might not even do that, have that option. So yeah, unless they probably not, no, because you could lose money that way either way. So
Either way, they might lose money,
yeah, either way they might lose money. So it's an option, I guess. It's there if you want to use it, you can definitely use it. It's an option, you know, options are good, right? So yeah, pretty much. So, all right. So I guess we basically covered that topic. What we got next?
Fallout 4 patch allegedly boosts performance through visual downgrades
Oh,
on
baby
PC,
Jesus.
PS4, and Xbox One.
Now, why do I feel like everything is synchronized? Which is weird. Like I feel like if they do it for Xbox and PS4, they got to do it in the PC. Why would you want to downgrade performance on the PC? I don't understand, since we have the capable hardware. So here we got a photo here that definitely shows. You can definitely see the shadows in the fan. Okay, can we slide over? I can't. Oh. Okay. So you can definitely see the probably dynamic shadows there with the is that yeah, that's a fan. It looks way more realistic compared to this picture right here, which they took the shadows away. And you can definitely see 30 right there. It shows 3 and it'll cut out 0, but it's 30 versus 28. And it could even, I think, drop down as low as 20 frames per second. I've read. Sorry, I'll just.
I have a little opinion. How about they actually
Let's improve.
optimize the game instead of making the game look worse for us? Like, yes, the game still does look nice, but still,
Hold up, look at that. Look,
why
oh.
should we be forced to downgrade our graphics without no say in the so? Without, it's just like they're forcing us to play the game at a lower fidelity than we know that we could run at.
Don't understand why they're doing it on the PC. If do whatever you want on the PS4 and Xbox One, I don't know why I do it on the PC also. I don't understand why. They should just have it as a graphic option to turn it off. If that's the case, rather than just like if they completely just remove it from the game. So I'm definitely seeing 20 frames per second, and on the this is PS4, so this is the PS4 patch, and where he's getting 20 frames per second with patch 1.01, he's actually getting 30 frames per second on 1.02. So it's a performance improvement, definitely. That's good. I still don't understand why they would do that on the PC. And I think there was a screenshot here, the PC version screenshot. You see the shadows is gone. The dynamic shadow is actually gone from it. So,
Now they're static.
this is really. I can't understand if you want to do it in the PS4 and Xbox One, the consoles, because they have less powerful hardware. That's fine. You want to do it there, that's totally fine. But as PC gamers, if you have the hardware to push it, you know, you should definitely have the option, instead of just removing it, have the option to turn that feature off, you know, like, you know, with all graphic settings. So I just definitely don't see the reason as to why they would do it in the PC also.
So. And it seems like this is like the new thing, because Call of Duty also did the same thing.
Yes, they did. And yes, they did.
Really, they just made a patch Tuesday. Mm-hmm. I've just hopped on a game, I believe 2 days ago, I was playing Call of Duty. Yeah. And I went to my options. I cannot play on Ultra settings no more.
Interesting.
And so I went around
on the phone
trying to see what's going on. Come to find out, what Call of Duty just did is that they're forcing us to play at a resolution. I mean, not resolution, at a graphics quality that they believe that we can run at, based on our VRAM amounts. Since I have a 290 and I have 4 gigs of RAM,
right?
They will not let me play on extra textures.
Oh.
And so I have to literally go through the config files and set my configurations in order for me to play what I used to play normally.
That's horrible.
Extra textures at 2K 60 frames per second on multiple. And now I'm forced to play at 2K high settings on multiplayer. I'm really not feeling that.
Funny thing is, I actually have the game. I'm having a lot of fun with it. I'm not gonna lie to you. My friend, he played. He uninstalled it 2 minutes afterwards again, like he did in the beta. I also, with the games, it's kind of off topic, I understand, but certain modes are already dead, man. Like, I tried going into Demolition and Domination, and I had to wait. So, and Team Deathmatch are getting instantly. So, and that's kind of the downfall of Call of Duty now on the PC. It just, some modes just die quickly. Even though Team Deathmatch is totally fine. I'd just like to play some other modes, you know? Like, I definitely enjoy that in MW2, I know, off topic. But, did this thing just turn down the graphics? I'm at HD, but why is it showing so blurry? This is really weird. Anyway,
that's because of the type of anti-aliasing they are using. They're using that Filmatic type of aliasing, so it like kind of blurs it, and at the same time make it more deeper, so that it's simulating like a movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I have no issue. I haven't tried that with the extra textures and Black Ops. I'm probably gonna do this right after this tech update. Tech gaming update. I'm actually trying it because I had no issue. I was at it ran me at 1440p. Everything turned pretty much almost up. I had to turn some other stuff up, but is the game locked at 60 frames per second?
No, it's not.
So why am I only getting like 61 frames per second no matter what the hell I do? Well, almost no matter what I do. It just seems to
sync frames on.
No, I turned it off. It was on. I was like, why? What is it? When I first went into a match, I was actually like, what the hell is this? And I turn it off. So, and I'm still like 61, 62, which is weird. I don't drop below 60. So, it could be that the GPU is pretty much maxed out because I am at 1440p. The graphics turned all the way up for the most part. I didn't go too deep into it, but everything that was in the front of me, I just turned it as high as I can to see what it could do. And it was running pretty smooth. Silky smooth, no frame drops, none of that stuff. So, it's pretty good.
I tend to run at 70 frames per second because I have a monitor that can run at 75. Uh-huh. So, I tend to run at 70 frames per second on call.
Okay. That's cool. Maybe I should the max clock, my max overclock I could do on my monitor is 70 frames per second. 70 hertz, actually, 70 frames per second, 70 hertz. I could probably go 72, but after that, it just doesn't work.
The max overclock I could do with my monitor is 75.
Yeah, mine only does 72, because it's a baby.
All right, next topic.
Yeah, let's move on to the next topic.
Closed it down by mistake.
You closed it down by mistake?
Okay, I got it back up.
The Xbox One and PS4 to see high sales next year. They're predicting the end of cycle for the current gen consoles by 2019. And, you know, it's coming. It was a long time coming. We saw, I kind of saw this coming a little bit, especially since they can't even hit 1080p
Everybody's seen this coming.
at 60 frames a second. That's kind of where you kind of want to be right now when it comes to playing games at 60. And for those of you out there saying you can't see the difference, how do you help these people? I don't know how to help these people.
They're just denying the fact that they can see 60 because they did not upgrade to the PS4 simply because it could play PS3 games at 30 frames per second. That's not why they upgraded.
Yeah, so this is gonna happen. So likely right now they're probably planning stuff out. The Xbox One could definitely be more powerful because of its size. Like I could definitely see it, having a really powerful CPU and GPU because of its size and having more, surface area to cool down the components. It should have really took it away, but they were kind of focused on games and entertainment, where the so PlayStation 4 is so focused on just gaming as the main thing. So, I mean, that's good. It's fine. I still do plan on picking up a PS4 anyway to play some of the exclusives. So, yeah. So probably likely right now they're prepping to see what hardware they want to put inside these consoles for the next PS5, Xbox 2. I don't know what they're gonna call them. Probably PS5 for sure. I know the PlayStation gonna be like PS5 next. I don't know what Xbox gonna do over there. I don't know what they're doing right now with Xbox One. But yeah, this is something that was a long time coming. Some games struggle, frame rate. I mean, okay, frame rate drops could definitely be because of, bugs in the software and the games, optimizations. So, or even them even having to turn some things down, later on in the cycle. Faster hardware is what we need. 1080p 60 FPS is totally okay.
I
And
think they need to do what they did in the 360 and PS3
PS3,
game
yeah, it was.
days,
There was a
where they
point
was
in
top
time.
of the line.
There was a point in time where the PS3 and the Xbox 360 outbeaten the PC. Crazy. I know, it's crazy, but could they keep up? I don't. Not anymore, I don't think. I mean, and that's nothing wrong with that. It's not saying something wrong with that. It's nothing wrong with that. It's just that, these higher end components are going to be way more expensive. You end up paying $1,000 for a PS4. That's not, nobody's going to do it. So they got to work within that budget, probably under $600, 650. I would say 650 is okay. You got people out here going out every day buying brand new iPhones and Android phones and stuff like that for $600, $700 for tax and everything like that. So it depends on where you live. But the base phones right now are like 650. And people out there going out there every day, and they're getting new cell phones. Not every day, but every year, every revision, they're getting a new cell phone. So I would say 650 is a good price for the next generation consoles. A little hard on the wallet, I understand. But for the best experience, we gotta make a little sacrifice. So maybe like around 550 is totally okay. And make them powerful, so that we can get better graphics and gameplay is okay. I'm not saying graphics is the only thing. Obviously, graphics is not the only thing. I'm not gonna sit here and play a beautiful game, but it got shitty dialogue and all that stuff in there. I'm not gonna do that. So, but having more powerful hardware is definitely a must. We need 1080p 60 on every game. And yeah, so 650 is totally fine, but having it at $400 actually is more affordable to more people in that spectrum. But I see a lot of people still go out there and they're paying for these phones. So, even if you do go get a contract, you're still paying for the phone either way.
Just like how people say that PC gaming is too much, it costs too much to build a PC
See.
and to start gaming on it. I mean, but if you sit down and think about, okay, so if you got a PS4 when it launched, that was 400. You wanted a controller, that was $60. That's $60 per controller. Usually people have four controllers or more. So that's right there. That's 240.
I
Off
didn't
just right off just off the back off of controllers.
four controllers usually what?
Yeah,
I
controllers
think
are
I think the
usually
more
$60.
the average I think is like two controllers. I don't know about four. I think more is like two because you and
Everybody
your
I know,
friend.
well,
Oh, okay.
as of me and my friends,
Yeah, okay.
that the average that we have is four controllers because we play a lot of
Okay.
multiplayer games.
All right.
Now, if you play single players a lot, then it's obviously gonna be cheaper for you. But if you play a lot of multiplayers like 2K and Madden and stuff like that, then more controllers is usually where you'll be at.
All right. But yeah, the way I look at it is, okay. The PS4 is $400. A PC is a decent PC, from Best Buy is like $500, right? So that's already $900 right there. So basically what I look at is you're kind of taking a PlayStation 4 Plus, more powerful, and you're just putting it inside of a computer. And basically there's your gaming system and a computer, and your everyday task is going to be faster if you got an SSD inside of there, which they're pretty cheap now. And that's kind of how when people are like, oh my God, gaming PC is so expensive. I'd be like, yo, do you have a PC right now? Yes. How much you pay for it? Like 500, $400. Okay. You got a PS4? Yep. That's $400, right? So imagine taking those two and putting them together and there's your PC right there. But except the PC would be more powerful than the PS4. So,
And my PC didn't cost nowhere. My PC was around the same price as the Xbox One when it released. And I have really high-end hardware. So
Yeah,
it's
so.
not, if people can't, I mean, if that's another thing from saying that they are too expensive, then saying that you don't want to deal with the headaches. If you want to say that, then that's a pretty reasonable claim. But if you say they're too expensive, that's not really. Of course, they're going to be too expensive if you're looking at the end all be all of hardware.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, what I'm going to put in my computer, I'm going to put a 5960X. I'm going to go get three Titan X's. Yeah, they're going to be really expensive.
Yeah. So you can get a pretty good gaming PC for around $800. So yeah, pretty much. You can definitely with $800, you could definitely do 1080p 60 FPS, but I don't know. The graphic settings ain't gonna be ultra. And that's okay, because sometimes you have a graphics option in the game and you turn it, you went from low to like ultra and you might not even notice a difference in the game. So, but medium settings is even, I used to play medium settings, I had no problem with it. So it's totally fine. What's really gonna probably come into play is more like the textures and
And
mainly.
shadows.
Shadows, yeah, low shadows, medium shadows is okay, Ultra makes it look a little bit better, but it just sucks a lot of performance.
Yes, it
So,
does.
yeah. All right. So yeah, we can definitely expect new consoles coming out 2019, 2020, around there. Maybe So we'll definitely see. Keep in touch with this. So yeah. All right, so what we got next? What's going on next?
Five new AMD FreeSync monitors debuting at CES from LG. And wait, what the hell? Where did this come from?
Where did that come? This I'm like what? Where did that come
Yeah,
from?
I don't know where that came from.
Okay, I got
AMD
one.
winter sale to begin on December 22,
Yeah, I was
2020.
actually clicking on it. Oh, gaming. Oh, at me. All right, let me not forget about that. All right, what's the next picture? Okay. So,
Yeah, so it's still winter sale.
ready your wallets. And December 22nd, Steam, bunch of sales. Where's my wallet at?
A lot of money off.
Yeah, let me see my
You
wallet real
know.
quick. Oh shit, look. It's empty. It's empty. But I got cards, so I don't know. I don't really have any. I got like a few games I might want to pick up here and there, but nothing too crazy.
But
So
Steam is pretty. Hey, one thing I can say is Steam is really smart when it comes to these sales, because when you have something on the sale, usually it sells more than at its regular price.
Right.
And they ha and Steam has a lot of
Definitely.
sales.
People wait for this, you know? Like people like, you know, they'll wait. The game comes out, I'll wait. You know, sale, we got sales coming up, random sales sometimes, games go on sales randomly. Grand Theft Auto 5 went on sale for like $35, I think, a few days ago, weeks ago, a week ago or so. So it happens randomly. Even Borderlands, you know, so all games, you know. But yeah, I'm definitely looking to pick up like, you know, Dying Light. Maybe Borderlands, I don't even know. So I have no idea. But that's pretty much all the games I want to up. American Truck Simulator doesn't come out till next year. But yeah, a lot of these games are gonna
User
go
in
on
your
sale.
channel timed out.
And he just timed out for some reason. Oh. So this maybe his computer crashed. Let's just give him a second to come back in. So while we wait for him to come back in, he could take a little while to come back online. Here my wish list, you know. I mean, if you wanna, you know, dimension it to be fine. If you wanna like throw some my way, I'm not gonna say nothing, you know.
User joined your channel.
Welcome back. Woo!
I'm back, you guys. Sorry for
It
the inconvenience.
is all good. We just have like one more topic to go over, and then we are all Black Ops 3. And then we're pretty much good to go and get out of here.
And
So
before we start with the last topic, I want to let everybody know what just transpired. I
okay.
have, as of right now, we are having some electricity issues with ComEd and the wire outside that's connected to the electricity pole is loose. So when we use a lot of so when at certain times it's like the electricity tweaks.
All right. So yeah, hopefully you get that fixed soon. So
Yes, they should be coming out tomorrow.
all right, that's good. That's good news. All right, so let's move on to Nintendo NX console's controller could be a giant touchscreen like a cellular device. Like a cell phone.
I cannot wait to see it. A lot of people don't know, but I'm a big Nintendo fan. I'm now one thing I'm not is a Nintendrone, but I am a big Nintendo fan, and I feel like whenever they bring something new to the table, they're just like they're just like Apple. They never do it mediocre. Like with the Wii, with the motion controller, that set the world on fire. Now with the Wii U, it really got ignored. But with the tablet was a really nice addition to the Wii U. Like, granted, it should have never been the main controller, but it was a really nice addition to the Wii U. And one of the biggest mistakes I feel like they made with the Wii U is marketing. A lot of people thought it was an add-on to the Wii. Because, I mean, if you name something the Wii U, people gonna, and then you show off the tablet and not really the console, I'm gonna think it's an add-on and I'm not gonna think it's a brand new system. So I feel like they messed up with their advertisements also. But when it comes to Nintendo and their products, whenever they introduce a new feature, they always do it well. The motion controllers for the Wii, the tablet with the Wii U, the 3D with the 3DS. They always do it. They always make sure they put a lot of effort into those features. So I feel like with the new all touch screen controller, I feel that it will have force touch just like the iPhone.
Definitely. Okay. See, I don't know. A lot of fans, especially a lot of older fans, they're gonna want some buttons up in here. I see some two buttons on the top, but the main screen, I don't know. It could be an added accessory, added controller, you know, besides the probably a different one that you can actually buy. But I don't know how well this would actually do if this is the actual only controller And it's just touch screen because I on my phone I tried playing the old Game Boy games on it and it just doesn't work that well. Of course, games are designed for it works, but I'm not a whole fan of the whole leaning thing. So they're gonna have to really probably make multiple controllers. Maybe is what I'm thinking.
Feel like they would have a conventional controller.
Yeah,
addition to the touchscreen controller.
That would be better.
Conventional controller would not have the amount of features that the touchscreen will have.
Yeah, I totally understand that. But some people just want the buttons, man. Uh-huh. They want the buttons. Need the buttons. You know, they want something they can actually feel pressing down. So I mean, you get the vibration on the touchscreen on the screen. On the, you know, iPhones does have the vibration where it probably does feel like you're clicking on something, but they want to. Maybe you want to feel it. I don't know. It might work. I don't know if it will. I kind of have my doubts with it. Like I said, I know they need a conventional controller. So definitely with actual buttons on top of it. You know,
as of speaking about Force Touch, even though this is way off topic, the Galaxy S7 is rumored to have Force Touch.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, it's going to happen. Definitely, it's going to happen. It's a nice feature. I sit around with the phone. I tap it. And I press hard. It's like, oh, this is so cool. I don't know why. Yeah. I'm so amazed by it. Like, it might seem silly. Like, oh, it's a right click. It is a great right click. Okay, I love it. I love that option. It's quick. Like, you're able to, you press it on the phone. I'm talking about the phone. You press it on the phone. You hold it down. You get the quick options. Right? So, it's faster. You know, it's pretty cool, too.
Yeah, even though the MacBook isn't really as powerful as it should be. And it does get outperformance by the iPhone 6. It's still a pretty, it does have nice features and a really good looking screen. I think it's 2304 by 1440.
I haven't used it. I've never used Hackintosh. Never touched the MacBook. You know, I'm sure it's nice. You know, but yeah. Mess around with Hackintosh, you know. But that's pretty much it. Apple does make some pretty good products. So I can't really knock them on that one. Yeah. All right. So is anything else you want to say about the controller?
One thing they cannot replace with touch is the triggers. I feel like they cannot take the triggers away.
And some people feel like they need the buttons too. So the buttons on the top, like, you know, X and B and all that stuff, A and B. So and some people just might not be, they have to release a conventional controller. So alongside with this, it's totally okay. But just this itself, it's just not going to work. So.
Yeah, so that's pretty, I'm interested in this. I want to see what they do.
Yeah, well, can't really knock it out there.
Make me want the next Nintendo console instead of making me feel like I have to get it because of my Pokemon.
Ah, Pokemon. Gotta catch 'em all. All right,
as
that's weird.
I will be buying a Wii U simply because Pokemon Tournament is coming out on it.
The what tournament?
Oh, you haven't heard of it? It's no. It's a fighting Pokemon game. It's using the engine from Tekken. And as of right now, it looks amazing.
Okay, well, I'm gonna have to look into that.
Yes.
Okay. So I think that's all the topics we have for today. Thank you, Thomas, for coming on here.
And thanks for having me.
Yeah, no problem. I'm going to definitely leave a link in the description below so that people can subscribe to you and any other social networking sites you want to put on there. So, yeah, thank you guys for watching. And that means 80% chance that we'll be back next week. All right, so.
Yeah, so I'll see you guys then.
All right. All right. Bye.